Hear now the word of our Lord for our day. Now every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they went up as usual for the festival. And when the festival ended and they started to return, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but his parents did not know it. Assuming that he was in the group of travelers, they went a day's journey. Then they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. And when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. And when his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety." And he said to them, "Why were you searching for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" But they did not understand him. And then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor. The word of the Lord. Let's begin with prayer. Gracious God, you sent us your Son so we might find our way home to you. Help us hear your word in Scripture this morning. Open our eyes and ears that we might discover the joy that has eluded us, yet is present with us always. Your constant love. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Anyone who braves the Christmas crowds in New York City would know what to expect. New York City at Christmas time is a packed madhouse scene. A lot of folks would rather stay home. But there are the shows and the lights, the dancing Rockettes, the big Christmas tree in Rockefeller Center, and the display-sized skating rink just beneath it. And there are the miniature store window displays, town and country scenes in the windows of Macy's and Saks Fifth Avenue and Lord and Taylor. They have their allure. It's almost worth the crowds. For many, the crowds are what make it Christmas. But when you live in New York City, as my family and I did for many years, there's really no avoiding the challenge of Christmas crowds wherever you go. One year when our daughters were very young, 5 and 3, we were in Bloomingdale's intent on crossing through the store in order to cut from 3rd Avenue to 2nd by this festive interior route, more for the warmth than the shopping. This was back in the day when December was a cold and snowy month. We had just reached the entryway to the coat department, a vast, high-ceilinged room filled with coats of every size and shape. They hung from shoulder-high circular racks. They were shoulder-high for an adult, that is. For a 3-year-old, you looked up at the forest of coats. They were like trees to dance through. And that is exactly what our then 3-year-old daughter did. With her own coat tied around her shoulders like a cape, she pulled away from my hand and ran off laughing, skirting around and under the coat trees, her arms wide like she might take flight. And I laughed too, at first, and then I turned to show Andre with what our energetic daughter was up to, but he was wide-eyed and panic-stricken. "Go get her quickly," he said. "She could be lost. Anyone could take her." And I saw he was firmly holding tight to the hand of our older child, who would have loved to follow her sister in flight. That's when panic attacked. I looked back and realized that our daughter Amelie was now completely out of sight, hidden by the sea of coats that engulfed her. I felt that sickening fear seep through me as I took off running in her general direction, following the telltale signs of swinging coats and hangers as she made her way through the coat department. I dodged shoppers and I realized I could not see her anymore, but I had the longer legs for a foot race. And I quickly caught up with her as she cut across the snow park section. I scooped her up, but she squirmed to get free. How could I interrupt her adventure? "But you can't run away in a department store," I pleaded. I tried to explain, but she kept pounding me with angry fists, and I held on to her tight. She just said to me, "I'm not lost. I wasn't lost. I was flying." Now, Joseph and Mary's boy was a little more down to earth, at least when he was 12. But still, they knew that sick feeling of having a child disappear on them, whether for a few minutes, or in their case, for a terrifying 3 days. We can almost imagine what it must have been like for them, Mary and Joseph, traveling to the temple in Jerusalem as they did every year at Passover time. In accordance with the best practices of the Jewish tradition, they were a good religious family, doing the right thing. They traveled safely with a large group coming by caravan, all family and friends from Nazareth in Galilee. They were not bad parents. They worshiped together and celebrated the festival of Passover in Jerusalem, the Seder meal, the prayers, and the one question for the youngest child: what makes this night different from all other nights? And maybe Jesus was the one who answered it. And as the festival ends, they begin the long journey back to Galilee. But Jesus stays behind. Mary and Joseph assumed he was with their group of friends. He was 12 years old, nearly a man in the Jewish tradition. They would not have left holding his hand. But still, by nightfall, when families should have been gathering at individual campfires or shared a tent or pitched out a blanket to sleep on overnight, Jesus did not join them. Joseph and Mary started to look for him among their relatives and friends. Then it would have sunk in. Jesus was gone. They'd lost him. Mary and Joseph must have realized it together, maybe looking at each other deep in the eyes, that ghastly panic setting in the pit of their stomachs. They had left without their child. And not just that, they both knew it was worse. They had lost the Christ. Imagine trying to explain that one to God. Not so long ago, I heard a story about a little girl named Debbie who took a local bus on a trip to a nearby shopping mall with her older brother. Now, somehow they got separated among the crowd of people getting off the bus as it pulled up to the mall stop. The brother got off and expected his sister to be right behind him, but she was not. She had not been able to move past the other passengers jostling at the door, and the girl, who could not have been more than 6 or 7 years old, found herself stuck on the bus, riding on to the next town. She was about ready to cry when they pulled up to the next bus stop. But then she saw out the window a policeman standing nearby. And the police officer was smiling and laughing, talking to a Santa who stood next to a Salvation Army worker ringing a bell for Christmas charity. She got off the bus and ran over to them. Just hearing about it, we have to marvel at her luck. She was lost and scared, but knowing she could get help from Santa, the Salvation Army, and a police officer, we know no harm could come to her. But before I tell you how her story ends, let me say that it's Luke's gospel story of Mary and Joseph losing the boy Jesus that made me think of this other lost child. I find myself imagining how young Debbie's brother must have felt when he got off the bus and turned around to find no little sister in tow, but sees only the exhaust fumes of the bus as it pulls away. Feel my own heart clutch as I imagine her parents' faces as the boy returns home alone and tries to explain what happened, the fear and panic that must have set in as the whole family geared up to search for their youngest child, lost among the mall shoppers at Christmas time. Now, 3 days later, 3 days, they find him. Back in Jerusalem, Mary and Joseph have retraced their steps. They look in every ditch and gully, every marketplace and well. They must have been scared to death that they'd either find him dead or not at all. And the very last place they go is the temple itself, considered the only true place of worship, the place where God resides. Of course, this is where they find Jesus. Jesus at home with God, because Jesus was never lost. He was there the whole time, in his Father's house, in God's house, the place he was led to and destined for. Mary and Joseph are as peeved and relieved as you and I might be. Child, how could you do this to me? We were so worried. We know they love their son. We know that losing Jesus was a mistake. They want him back. But even as they try to scold him, Jesus stands his ground. How is it possible you had to search for me? How could you not know that I was right here the whole time in my Father's house? Where else would I be? Jesus was found right where they'd left him, in the temple. He had spent the last 3 days there among the elders and the rabbis, listening and asking questions. And when his parents finally found him, it was Jesus who was doing the teaching and providing the answers. And all were amazed at his understanding and his answers. He had been teaching the elders of the temple, teaching the religious experts, the ones with doctorates in theology, the rabbis, the clergy, about the nuances of the scripture. He was a boy raised up in the faith, one he had come to know through persistent and regular visits to the temple. Scripture tells us that his parents went to Jerusalem every year for the festival of the Passover. It is encouraging to note that it was Jesus' parents who gave him his start in religious education. Yes, we adults are responsible to model the faith for our youth. Attending worship matters. Even for Jesus. Imagine what dire straits we'd all be in if his parents hadn't taken him to Sunday school. And as Jesus explained his case to his parents, that he was safe and sound in his Father's house, where he belonged, teaching as a rabbi would, as a teaching elder would, Mary's heart must have filled with joy, for she saw it then. The man who her son was becoming, a teacher, a rabbi, God's servant. And she treasured all these things in her heart. It was true what the shepherds had said to her the night of his birth, reporting the angel's good news. Born to you this day in Bethlehem, the city of David, is a savior, the Messiah, the Lord. She couldn't have forgotten, for she had treasured those words in her heart. But who knew, maybe they meant Jesus would grow to be a warrior fighting for freedom against the Romans. Or maybe the shepherds meant he'd be a political orator who would maneuver his way to a place in local government and free the Jews from the oppression of the tyrant King Herod. But it was here, in the temple, Mary and Joseph find Jesus, just 12 years old. In the temple, Mary finds Jesus for the first time. Mary sees and hears from the lips of her own son, firsthand, the first signs of his destiny being fulfilled. Her son is a teacher, already a rabbi, anointed by God and blessed by the angels, imbued with the knowledge of God's word and scripture and all the laws and ordinances set down there. Jesus was just beginning to live out his true calling to serve God and teach God's people a radical, wonderful, peaceful way of life, a faithful way of life. And Mary recognized it, as we might, when we first see a child blossom with new interests and passion. Suddenly he's a dancer. She's a musician, a gifted athlete, a creative artist, a writer with a knack for words. We know that child, the one with a passion for animals who becomes a vet, the one who cared for others always and she becomes a nurse. We've noticed the one with the tender heart, the sympathetic ear, an eye for color, a passion for cooking, a love for other children, a leader among peers. We see it as parents, and sometimes here in church as a congregation, we see our children grow and blossom. From shy to outgoing, in the children's choir, the Christmas play, in the youth group, and in the classroom. We all have a calling. Jesus received his in the temple, and that is where his parents found him. But Jesus was never lost, never has been, never will be. It's we who need to be found. Sometimes it happens. It was God at work through the policeman who found Debbie, the little girl I told you about earlier. Debbie got off the bus and went bravely up to the police officer and said, "Can you help me? I'm lost." And the officer asked her where she lived, but she could only remember the name of the town, not the street address. So he took her by the hand and put her in the front seat of the police cruiser, and they drove to her little donut hole of a town next door. They drove up and down the main street to see if she recognized anything as being near her neighborhood. And finally, they drove down a side road by a beautiful white clapboard building with white pillars out front, separated from the street by a large green grassy lawn. The building had a tall, slender steeple with a gold cross on top and a Christmas wreath on the front door. "Oh," she said, "stop the car. That's my church. I know the way home from here." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.